Hello everyone, myself Dr. Babita Parashar. I'm an associate professor with Faculty of Education and Humanities at Manavrishna University, Faridabad. Today, we'll be discussing about the recent trends in science curriculum. When we talk about science, the first thing that we start with is the contents of the module. We'll be talking about science as a discipline, an ideal science curriculum as per NCF 2005, which is National Curriculum Framework, the recent trends, which ranges from e-learning, a STEM-based classroom, virtual reality, augmented reality, and now the something which across the world we are discussing, the Sustainable Development Goals, which is also United Nations 2030 agenda. So the best way to learn science is to do science. When I say the best way to do science is that we read about something, we perform it. If we would like to draw and explain it, talk about it in detail, express our understanding, write it and share the knowledge generated out of it, and get back to reading again. So that's the cycle where we talk about science as by doing. India is probably the only country where in the constitution they have mentioned in Article 51A, which says to develop scientific temper, humanism, and the spirit of inquiry and reform. A constitution of a country, if it talks about developing scientific temper, from that we can understand what emphasis has been given to science, not just as a discipline, but a line of thought, an approach towards things by the country itself. Curriculum, etymologically, it originates from a Latin word curere, which means to run a course, roadmap or guideline for any discipline. So when we talk about science curriculum, it is the roadmap to develop a sense of inquiry, humanitarian values, and so on and so forth. The various stakeholders in a curriculum, according to Tyler has been a stalwart in the area of curriculum development. So Tyler talks about the various stakeholders, which is the learner for whom the curriculum has been designed and to be transacted, the society in which the learner will be working with that knowledge gain, the subject matter on which the emphasis is being laid, that if I say again, going back to our constitution provision, that if I have to develop humanitarian values, through what content I intend to develop this, so. And the teacher, the most important stakeholder in the entire process, on whom lies the entire responsibility of transacting the curriculum. The various types of curriculum which has been discussed globally, first of them, the subject-centered curriculum, the learner-centered curriculum, and the problem-centered curriculum. If I briefly elaborate on that, the subject-centered is that if we are talking about the science curriculum, it has to talk about science as a discipline. So in our country, till grade 10, it is the interdisciplinary integrated approach which is for the science. When we come to senior secondary, it is based on the different subjects like physics, chemistry, biology, so on and so forth. The learner-centered, where the entire emphasis of the curriculum is given on the learner. Activity, experiential learning, learning by doing, that is how the curriculum is being designed and shaped if it is a learner-centered curriculum. And the third one, equally important one, where the curriculum is problem-centered. By problem-centered, like if we say, which is again gaining a lot of ground, which is project-based learning or problem-solving approach, where the curriculum is aligned on developing a skill, lateral thinking, logical thinking. So the entire curriculum is framed in such a way that it is grooming the learners towards the problem-solving approach. An ideal science curriculum is required to have validity across the domains. So when we talk about cognitive validity, a science curriculum need to ensure that the learner is the cognition part of a learner is being taken care of in detail. When we talk about content validity, whatever content has been mentioned in the curriculum is verified, it is tested, it is checked, and then it has been authenticated to be involved in the curriculum. At the same time, when we say process validity, that how this content will be delivered is also to be mentioned in the curriculum. So the process of delivery, that the transaction modalities also need to be taken care of in detail. Historical validity. When any content is included, it need to also take care of that what is the historical perspective which led it to here. Like if we talk about an atom, so it is very, very important that we talk about in curriculum that how the atom was being discovered, how the various components, when we talk about the subparts of an atom were discovered, who are the people who led to the discovery of the atoms, electrons, protons, neutrons, giving them their due credit. And then only the curriculum is justified in the right spirit. The next validity which we need to ensure in a science curriculum is the environmental validity. Any content, when it is being delivered, it also need to ensure that it is through content or through curriculum, we are not transacting anything which will not be taken in the right light for our environment. Because the strength of any curriculum or any school system is basically when we talk about 3 P's, which are also the pillars for sustainability. When I talk about 3P, the first one is the planet. We need to think about the planet as the first stage. Any piece of knowledge, any piece of discovery, invention is futile if it is not taking care of your planet. The second P in the same area of sustainability is the people. After planet, your fellow beings on the planet need to be taken care of. So any discovery or invention which somewhere down the line would be hazardous for the people or the planet need not be taken forward or need not to be integrated into the curriculum transaction. And the last P in these 3 P's is the profit. Any curriculum, any content, discovery, invention which is being made, it also need to help in the revenue generation of the people who are doing it. So it is important that when any science curriculum or any curriculum to be even more broad is being designed, that these validities need to be taken care of. And last but not the least is the ethical validity. Like in our science classroom, when we talk about nuclear fission and fusion, we do teach our students that the atomic bombs or the nuclear bombs are based on the fission and the fusion process. At the same time, the ethical validity of the curriculum is that we also need to communicate to the class that the nuclear power generation is also being done to the same process. So if we are talking about fusion in the process of atomic bomb, it would be hazardous for the humanity as a whole in the long run. So if I just conclude this slide, so an ideal science curriculum need to ensure the cognitive validity, the content validity, the transaction modalities or the process validity, the historical validity to ensure that the right kind of credit is being given to our scientists and the historians who led to the various discoveries and leading us to the growth in science. The environmental validity, as I just mentioned, in light of our 3 P's, your planet, the people and the profit of it, and the ethical validity, that any discovery, if in the long run or any invention in the long run is not in the favor of mankind or our Mother Earth, is not ethical. The National Curriculum Framework for School Education, which was given in 2000, NCFSC, it propounded the teaching of science and technology in class 6 to 10th as a single discipline. It was not bifurcated into physics, chemistry, biology, so on and so forth. So till grade 10, an integrated discipline was being approached, aiming to develop the skill of problem solving and decision making. When I say science is a way of life, science is not just a curriculum, it is not just a discipline. So if someone is sustainable in the thought process, इफ समवन इज साइंटिफिक और लॉजिकल इन अप्रोच और एटीट्यूड. सो दैट इज वॉट इज द अल्टीमेट ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ अ साइंस करिकुलम. द नेशनल करिकुलम फ्रेमवर्क NCF 2005 लेड टू अ पैराडाइम शिफ्ट वेयर फ्रॉम एक्विजिशन ऑफ नॉलेज टू कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ नॉलेज. सो NCF 2005 शेयर्ड इन एंड सजेस्टेड द कंस्ट्रक्टिविस्ट अप्रोच where they say that there is immense knowledge around us. From this knowledge to be converted into wisdom is the role of a science curriculum. So we have information, the information leads to knowledge, and the knowledge to be graduated to the stage of wisdom. And there were various ways and means which are being suggested in NCF that how this paradigm shift of acquisition of knowledge to construction of knowledge need to be taken care of and facilitated at the level of the student. The trends which were anticipated to follow NCF 2005 were a learner-centered curriculum, which was aiming to develop abilities in cognitive, its affective and psychomotor domain of the learners. By cognitive, we means the domains which is related to the head part, the thinking, logical approach, critical thinking. So that is one domain of it, the cognitive part. Affective domain, as we also discussed in our validity, the ethical validities, the environmental validity. So affective domain of a learner is something which is related to his or her heart. How I think about this entire process. If I come across any invention, what I feel about it. Like nowadays, we are talking about banning the single-use plastic. So when I say affective domain, that how it is leading to the landfills, how it is creating the pollution in the environment. So one of the major emphasis of NCF 2005 was also to polish and nurture the affective domain of the learner. And the psychomotor domain, a domain related to the hand part of it, learning by doing. I would like to involve myself, I would like to do it and then see and believe it. So as the saying also goes in science, that I hear, I forget, I see, I remember partially, and when I do it, I remember it completely. So these three domains were aimed by NCF 2005 when I just discussed about the paradigm shift about creation of knowledge also in the learner. The constructivist approach, there are various, the 5E and 7E approach which has been given in terms of constructivist approach, where we engage our learner, we involve our learner, and there are 5 E's which goes on in the constructivist approach, where knowledge construction is an evolving process. It is not a limited knowledge pool which is to be transacted by the teacher. So it is not the role of a sage on the stage, it is guide by the side. As a teacher, my role is to create those avenues and opportunities for my student and then hold their hand, facilitate them in this learning process and allow them to create their own knowledge pool out of whatever avenues has been created. So that is the constructivist approach, which says that knowledge is not permanent, it is evolving. And each child would evolve, generate, create it based on his or her experiences which are being offered and facilitated to the student. The learner-centered content, to develop skills in the process of science rather than just knowing content of science. If I elaborate on that further, if we just look back, the kind of questions which are being designed in line of the Bloom's taxonomy also would be confined to the initial verticals of it, which is the remembering part of it, the comprehension part. Now, when we say talk about the constructivist approach, we take our learner to the higher order thinking skills, where we expect our learner who is groomed in the process of science would be able to apply that knowledge gain, would be able to analyze a situation in terms of the knowledge gains, would be able to create a new skill set, would be able to create a new pool of knowledge for themselves. So the learner-centered content, which was being which was being proposed by NCF 2005 was to develop skills in the process of science rather than knowing content of science. So in terms of content, a teacher could ask that what is evaporation, where a child would write what has been learned or what has been memorized as a definition of evaporation. At the same time, when the query or the question raised by the teacher is about the process, the same teacher would ask that how evaporation takes place in nature. So from what to how, if the teacher takes the student, they would be able to now answer this question based on their observations also, that they might have done that experiment that I kept a bowl full of water under sun and I saw that the level of water in this bowl was reducing. So you need sunlight or you need heat, and then this water evaporates for that. So this was the difference from rote memorization to the process of science which NCF 2005 introduced. The pedagogical shift, it was from known to unknown. The role of the teacher was just to facilitate, guide and support learner to construct new knowledge. If we just talk about decades back, the teacher would be the guardian of the entire knowledge pool. Unless taught by the teacher, the possibility of a child learning was very, very dim. But now today we are in the era of the global learning pool. Internet has made it a very small world. Every information is being available just at the click. It is there in your hands, in form of your smartphones. So what is the role of a teacher when information is so easily available? And there, it is the role of the teacher to undergo a pedagogical shift in the classroom also, that whatever is already known to them, we take them to the unknown only by being a facilitator. So whatever, if we see that whatever tangles are there in the brain of the child by too much of knowledge, it is the role of the teacher to untangle all those wires and help in a clear conceptual development of the child. Now the concern here is that in a world where there is an oversupply of information, the ability to make sense of information is now the scarce resource. I have everything with me, but what do I need out of it is again a skill, because too much of anything is also not a very pleasant or desirable quality which is there, because the child might not be mature enough, or the child might not be ready to take to explore that ocean of information. So this information is to be translated into knowledge by the help of a teacher who is playing the role of a facilitator. If the content has changed, if the pedagogical approaches has changed, if the transaction modality has changed, the assessment mechanism is bound to change. As we just discussed also, that from the remembering and comprehension stages of Bloom's taxonomy, we need to graduate our learner to the analysis, application, create, evaluate stage. So in doing that, we also need to change the assessment mechanism overall. So when I talk about mechanism, instead of asking rote memorization based questions, we can evaluate our students on the project work. We can check them on presentations. We can evaluate on the portfolios being created by them. We can give them an opportunity to self-evaluate. When we create opportunities for students to self-evaluate themselves, we are also honing or polishing their reflective skills. If I just give an example here, there are several students who came up with a project and the science teacher asked them to display their projects. After the projects were being displayed, the teacher asked each of the student to explain that how that project has been created. If a project was being created on pollution, or the project was being given on non-biodegradable material, and the entire project has been made on a thermocol sheet, then the teacher could have asked that I've been asking you to make a project on biodegradable material and you have come up with a project on completely made through plastic strings or thermocol sheets. So do you think you have understood the biodegradable as a concept? These kind of evaluation practices, these kind of self-evaluation practices would facilitate a reflective component in the students. Every time when they would be asked to appear for an evaluation, it would give them an opportunity to stop, think, check themselves that whether I have actually understood or I need to further evaluate myself on my own standards before I'm being evaluated by my teacher. So the entire assessment mechanism will also need to be revisited under the constructivist approach. The utilization of assessment as a means to connect with the learners. As we just discussing that NCF 2005 came up with constructivist as an approach. Here, the idea was not to evaluate a student for promotion or detention. Here, the idea of assessment or evaluation was to know that whether the child has learned or we further need to sit, explore, work together, and then we can move ahead. So assessment should be moments of delight. I look forward to my assessment where I will be informed about my learning, where I'll be informed about what I further need to work upon. And this I would be doing in collaboration with my classmates and with my teacher. I would celebrate the result days and the learners because it is showing me a mirror that I have moved this many steps comfortably, happily, and I further need to know this, or I further need to read more, explore more before I can take these couple of more steps ahead. So it would encourage each learner to be more participative in the learning as a process instead of the decision making day. H5P and hot potatoes are interesting tools which can be used by a teacher while designing an interactive assessment strategies. The diversity and inclusion, again, one of the major suggestions of the NCF 2005 was that we all agree there's a lot of diversity which exists around us. This diversity varies from the learning styles, from the intelligences, from the caste, religion, creed, ethnicity, children with special needs, children who are not special in terms of that I can see. Like if I talk about a physically handicapped or a special, so I can see that there might be some special needs, but there are also some learning disabilities. Like if I just mention, so there are some learning disabilities like dyslexia, dyscalculia, dysgraphia, which is not as evident visually, but it exists. So the science curriculum also need to take care of all these learning challenges. So when we talk about diversity and inclusion, a science curriculum which caters to multiple learning styles, different intelligences level, at one stage we might have slow learners, on the other hand, we also have gifted learners in our class. So how our classroom practices need to be aligned for both of them, so that both on extreme, like from the slow learner to the average learners to the gifted learners, are being taken care of. Inclusion is not only about children with special needs, it is also about the children from different castes, religions, communities, ethnicities. Lot of migratory population we have in India. So these also need to be included when we talk about an inclusive classroom. So NCF 2005 also suggested to take care of diversity and inclusion in the science classroom. The approaches and strategies of learning. The constructivist approach, as we have been discussing, where the knowledge is not permanent, it is evolving. The child, based on the experiences, based on the exposure, would be able to create learning for himself. The problem-solving approach, from whatever concepts has been learned, these concepts need to be applied into the everyday life, and everyday life situations need to be overcome or solved through that. So problem-solving approach is an amazing approach of transacting curriculum to ensure that the students who have been groomed through this curriculum or who have been facilitated through problem solving approach are good citizens in the long run. The inquiry approach, where we polish or nurture the curiosity. So curiosity is a basic human trait. From a child who is just a couple of months old, puts everything in his or her mouth. Because oral learning is the only form of learning they have been exposed to. To gradually a child who's a toddler putting their fingers into the electric sockets. Further, they approaching and trying to see and question. So inquiry approach supported by the nurturing of the curiosity is a very strong way of delivering a content. Collaborative learning is the group work or the teamwork, where the entire group comes together with a common objective. They work on in different geographical locations, they work on different forums, on different platforms, and they come together for achieving a common objective. So collaborative learning is also a very important way of working on the social learning skills along with teaching them the scientific concepts. The cognitive conflict is that your upbringing or your cultural orientation tells you about something, but at the same time the concepts which are being taught in a science classroom conflicts with that. So cognitive conflict, if I give you a small example here, is like if in India there is a very strong perception that if you're going somewhere for something auspicious, or when you're just leaving out of your house and a cat crosses your road, it is not considered to be auspicious. You are expected to stop, you are expected to turn back, drop your plans, and so on and so forth. But when we talk about the cognitive conflict, at the same time a teacher would give them those opportunities to see the cause and effect of the same situation. That the teacher would create those forums or opportunities where the child would measure these myths or beliefs which they have been brought up in a particular community in terms of the scientific concepts which are to be delivered. So cognitive conflict is also a very effective way of teaching scientific concepts to a class. Analogy strategy, where we teach a concept and try to see that how it would be applicable. Like if I explain a small concept here, so we did one practice in our school where we invited some of the parents during an open house in a parents teacher meeting, and there were a lot of crayons which we have spread across in our classroom, and we asked the parents to pick up the colors of their choice and do whatever they want. We have instructed our parents that there would be another group working after them, so they have to be judicious about whatever they are choosing. So the parents picked up and drew something. After that, we asked them to take away the colors they have chosen with them only and wait in the another room. After them, the children of the same set of parents were invited to the same room, and with whatever remaining crayons were there, they came up with these pictures. So the parents, since they had a lot of choices in their color plates, they chose all the bright colors, they chose all the greens, they chose all the tulips, flowers, colors, everything. So what was remaining for our children to use was browns, grays, blacks, and all those dull colors. So through this analogy strategy, later we called both the sets of parents and children in the classroom and shared that this is what sustainability is all about. When you're using resources, although the instructor in the room did mention that there will be another group who would be coming and using these resources after you, the parent set took all the bright colors with them without giving any thought that who would be using them after them, and it was their children. So when we are teaching some concepts, analogy strategy comes out to be a bang-on approach which asks them to be reflective about what they're doing, to introspect their own practices, and then move on with that. The science curriculum for tomorrow, if you talk about. So This is, so far what we have discussed were the trends which were being proposed by INSEAD 2005. But if we talk about today, it is already almost 1.5 decade when the NCF has come up. We are already recently being come up with a draft new education policy in 2019. So lot many things have changed in these 1.5 decade long journey of science curriculum. Today we talk about ICT as an emerging, in fact established trend in science curriculum transition. Information and communication technology is not only supplementing what we are doing, it is also supporting it in a big way. So whatever the teacher is doing in a classroom, if it is supplemented by the ICT practices, it is resulting in a more effective learning in a classroom, which is more engaging, which is more rewarding, which is letting the students to be more involved in the entire learning process. The next approach to the science curriculum is STEM, which is science, technology, engineering and mathematics. As we just discussed that in 2000, National Curriculum Framework for School Education also suggested that technology need to be an integral part of science. Now the entire approach has been classified under STEM, which is science, technology, engineering and mathematics. In fact, a new development has come next after that, which is STEAM, where A has been added, which is about arts. So people from different orientations need to come together and work on their themes and projects and work for a sustainable society. After STEM, the new rage in today's global era is the virtual reality. A simulated experience that can be similar to the real world. It may not be very similar, but it will exposing you to the reality of this. So if I give you a small example that if you go to any mall or any gaming stations, they have these 7D games, or they have these 3D games, 5D games, where you would wear a special kind of eye gear. And through these eye gear, they would be introducing you to a complete reality in a virtual world. So virtual reality is also giving students a hands-on experience of something which is further supplementing their learning in a setup. Augmented reality is here to stay. It is here to conquer the world, which is about creativity and comprehension. If I talk about augmented reality, it is giving you, like when we were in school, we would be doing those dissection of mice to understand a mammal in the digestive system, circulatory system, the position, the location. But now, thanks to the animal rights activists and all, so dissections have been banned. But that cannot stop a child from learning and seeing a system. So augmented reality, which is showing you the entire system and in the real mode which is there. So these AR apps are also available in our smartphones. You can download an AR app and go through that. So an amazing experience is augmented reality, which gives to a student, which a teacher can facilitate. If we come down to ICT in science classroom, it is about e-learning. NIOS is doing an amazing work in there, where they're making the world come across to just a click. Across the nation, there are educators who are contributing to their content there, and in your comfort zone, in your premises, you have access to world-class content which is there. Swayam is another platform which is facilitating all these learning. Khan Academy, ArvindGuptaToys.com. So these are some of the ICT opportunities which can be explored by the teacher to facilitate the learning in a classroom. Utilizing digital means. So there are, just to add on to that list where I was talking about NIOS, Swayam, Khan Academy, there are different other science apps like Google Science Journal, which keeps you informed, updated about the various inventions across EdX, TED, TerraGenesis, BioInk, which is a biomedical plague, the sandbox. So these are some of the science apps which would ensure that the inquisitiveness of your child is sharpened, the curiosity is nurtured, and just a click away. Utilizing other digital means like Brilliant, YouTube, Bitsport, eBird, iNaturalist, Nova Elements, Genome, Catch, Play and Learn Science, whatever concepts are being theoretically taught or written in a textbook, these are some of the digital means, these are some of the apps which are there available on our smartphones, which would supplement your learning in a big way. The STEM classroom, as we just discussed, which is Science, Technology, Engineering and Mathematics, Atal Tinkering Labs by Niti Aayog are doing amazing work. They are giving those opportunities for the students to involve through STEM learning classrooms. They are developing their prototypes, they are testing their prototypes. So Atal Tinkering Labs is also a very good initiative by Niti Aayog, which is supporting STEM education in a big way. The virtual reality and augmented reality, as I just shared, in virtual reality we need a special kind of eye gear, and this eye gear would cost you some amount. But at the same time, when we talk about augmented reality, it is just an app, a specialized app, which can also be downloaded in your smartphones, and you can be informed more about that. And not just as a teacher and a basic science, even the surgeons, even the military operations, the pilot aptitude test, everything is being now moving to the augmented reality way, where they are being exposed to a real setup but in an augmented form. So if I give you a small example, a nurse, instead of directly pricking a patient, would be trying in an augmented form, pricking, identifying the right vein and moving on. So as a teacher also, as we can see in this picture, we can show the 3D model in an augmented form, the rib cage opening, and you can see the internal organs there, how are they being lined up. If we talk about fatty liver, what does it actually mean? So augmented reality is in a big way supporting the learning in our classrooms. Education for Sustainability, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. As I just quoted in that example, where the parents and the children, they drew something, the parents took away all the bright colors and the resources, and their own children were not left with many options but with the grays and the blacks, browns left to them. So United Nations have come up with this 2030 agenda, which is about you. It is also very popularly known as United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, UNSDGs. There are 13 goals which are under SDG goals, which ranges from no poverty, no hunger, electricity, water, sustainable energy, biodegradable, banning plastic, and the list, as I shared, is 17 long, where peace, inclusion, is ranging there. So from the constructivist classroom to augmented reality, virtual realities, the science curriculum also need to be aligned to the sustainable development goals. If the child from the onset is being trained in light of these sustainable development goals, they would be very aware citizens for tomorrow. Whatever loss has been done is being done, but in light of the sustainable development goals or SDGs, if the curriculum is designed, if the curriculum is planned, the curriculum is transacted, it will be doing a lot of U-turn in terms of whatever loss has been done to our three P's, which was planet, people and the profit which we aspire to make. Utilizing indigenous methods, when we talk about augmented reality, virtual reality, ICT, we need not to forget that there is also One India, which stays in India, which do not have access to all these high-tech resources. All the smartphone is reaching almost every nook and corner, but still we accept that it is not 100%. So there are some studies, some case studies which are being done, where science has been taught in mother tongue. Science has been related to the everyday life experiences which is being done there. So if I give a small example there, while teaching the concept of heat and pressure, so every mother would have someday asked the child to off the gas after a number of pressures in the cooker. So after 3 sounds, please off the gas. After 2 sounds, please off the gas. So these everyday practices need to be pitched in or involved in transaction of the curriculum. So one study which we are discussing about here is that the tribal children living in remote areas of Chhattisgarh, they were taught science in their dialect, their mother tongue, and then they were able to connect with it better. So another very popular study is Hole in the Wall. If I just give a small brief here, so in a remote village, so in a wall, a desktop was being just put up, entire computer was being put up and was just left without any support, anything. And after a couple of permutation combinations, after trial and errors, after seeing the cause and effect, a couple of days later, a group of children have learned to basically operate the computer. So when we talk about indigenous methods, hole in the wall or teaching in dialect are very effective ways. So teaching science by utilizing multilingual approach and minority languages. If I take you back to the first slide which we shared, that our constitution talks about developing scientific inquiry. So if the constitution talks about it, it has to reach every person, every individual residing that country. So the multilingual approach, teaching in their dialect, facilitating them, associating science with everyday learning, constructivist approach, these are some of the trends in science curriculum which have been catching up and which need to be supported and taken ahead. The points to ponder in this entire system is, if we just conclude our entire discussion, if we conclude this module, so we started with science. We discussed that science is all about learning by doing. We need to do something to learn it better. So as NCF 2005 also says, that the learner-centered curriculum need to be designed. When we talk about learner-centered curriculum, a curriculum which takes care of the cognitive, the affective, as well as the psychomotor domain. So a science curriculum which is taking care of all the domains of an individual is considered to be a good curriculum. An ideal curriculum is a curriculum which is validated from cognition to content to process to assessment practices on the basis of environment as well as the ethical validity. So an ideal science curriculum would ensure validity from your ethics to your cognition, from environment to content, from process to practices. That's a very good curriculum we talk about. Then the various approaches and strategies, as we were discussing, that the constructivist approach, collaborative learning, analogy strategy, cognitive conflict, cooperative learning, collaborative learning practices, problem solving approach. So these are some of the upcoming trends which need to be facilitated, used to be put in practice in a major way. And these approaches and strategies are not only going to add life to a science classroom, it will also take science from classroom to every life which is there. The assessment mechanism also, as we just discussed, if the content has changed, the transaction has changed, the focus of has moved from subject centered to the learner centered, the assessment mechanism also need to be revisited. So we also need to move from rote memorization to more involvement based assessment practices. So instead of a essay type paper, we can move on to project presentation, we can move on to self-evaluation, portfolios being generated, portfolios being developed. So these assessment mechanisms can be practiced in a more wider way to ensure that learning has been taken in the right way. The recent trends, as we just discussed, ICT, which is information and communication technology, whatever resources are being available, from your handheld devices to laptops, to iPads, to an iOS, SWAYAM platforms, which are so easily accessible, available to us. So these, all these facilities need to be used. So ICT, then we talk about STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. STEM has also moved a step ahead, and it has moved to STEAM, where the art or the aesthetic component also need to be taken care of. So next we move on to virtual reality. As we shared, that it would take you very, very close to the real world which is there. So if through a virtual reality you wish to see or feel what an astronaut would feel when they land in space, so through virtual reality you would be very closely able to have that feel, sense it, and gain access and learning to that. Then we come down to augmented reality. Augmented reality is going to show everything live. You do not need a eye gear for that, like we need it for a virtual reality, but augmented reality also brings you very closer as any individual can get to. Augmented reality is in a big way used for all the military operations nowadays. It is used for the surgeons to practice some very intricate, delicate surgeries beforehand. So augmented reality is supporting them. The same way, since we are not doing dissections in our classroom, through augmented reality, our teacher can also give experience to the students about the various internal organs and how they are placed and how delicately and beautifully nature has designed an individual, which is there. Then we talk about our United Nations 2030 agenda, which is about sustainable development goals. I also shared that example of the drawing competition where the parents took away the colors and nothing much in terms of colors and resources were left for children. So United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which are 17 in number, need to be known by a teacher and to be equally ensured to be informed to the students also. This would not only nurture them as good science students, this would also nurture them as global citizens. They would know that what does scarcity of resources mean. They would know that how water depletion would take them for tomorrow. They would know that how does not being included means. So United Nations Sustainability Development Goals is one of the new trends in science curriculum which need to be taken care of, and augmented reality and ICT in a big way can support us in that. So from that, thank you for this module and happy learning to all of you.